First of all, I feel standing up here that I'm just a little bit unworthy. I feel kind of amazed that as I look around to be here in this capacity speaking to you about my journey in the pro-life world. And I say this because I am sure that there are many of you who have been at this longer, done more in this service than I have yet to do. And probably, hopefully, with some more success as well. In that way, I feel very much like the 5 o'clock worker from this past Sunday's gospel, where I got called in late, but I'm blessed to have gotten the full day's wage. My background might be a little bit different than what we may hear from the remainder of the panelists. I guess I'm not sure, but I was born to a lower to middle class working family, blue collar, Democrat. My dad was a lineman for Boston Innocent. My mom was a waitress and the youngest of seven. And Methodist, I think, by default, because we lived across the street from a Methodist church. And I think that was the only way my mother could ensure that we would all get to church on Sunday was if we just went to the one across the street. The issue that we'd call pro-life today were not spoken about in our house. And like many of the best sermons, I think the best sermons are lived, not spoken. I say I was the youngest of seven. Really, I was the youngest of six. When I was very, very young, my mom's brother lost his wife in a tragic accident. And he had nine children and couldn't take care of them all. And so he had to split the family up, and we took the youngest girl, who was just about as old as my next older brother. But growing up, she was always our sister. There was no cousin involved. She was our sister, and I became the youngest of seven children. She was raised the same as us and maybe given a little bit more breaks at sometimes than some of us. And similarly, when my grandfather passed away, although it was not easy, my mother brought my grandmother into our home to live until her time came. This may not feel totally pro-life to you, but I will tell you that it set the stage for me on how you treat family. And then once you come to realize that we are all family, it sets the stage for how we're called to treat one another. My youth was all but misspent. But as with many men who lead or try to lead good Catholic lives, I have my wife of 25 years to thank for helping me to get to where I am today. So my journey as a young man of 27 years of little religion and likely less self-control, I stand before you this evening some 25 years late, not only speaking at a pro-life forum, but as an ordained minister in the Catholic Church. And how does that happen? The same way we're all standing here, by God's good graces. Through the prayers of my mother-in-law, of all people, though she didn't know it at the time, and the intercessions of St. Jose Maria Escriva, I am quite sure of, to whom she prayed on behalf of her daughter to find a husband, I met and I fell in love with my wife and married her. And we bought a home and we had two children. And if there is any power on earth to take someone and push them into a pro-life perspective, I'd say it might be having children. After our first two children, we sadly suffered a number of losses, a number of miscarriages. And I will tell you that if there is any power on earth greater than having children to push someone into a pro-life perspective, it is the loss of an unborn child. At this time, I began to take an interest in the Catholic Church. Frankly, selfishly, because every Sunday morning my wife would get up out of our bed and go to Mass. No matter how much I tried to persuade her to stay, church was that important. So I got up and I started following her. Out of my desire to be with her, I went to Mass. And see, here we are 25 years later and she's followed me into church. After a number of weeks, I finally got up the nerve to go and speak to our pastor after Mass one day, and please understand, I was still your textbook Protestant, albeit non-practicing, in a bad way, Protestant, because we all know and love many of our Protestant brethren. But I went into that sacristy to chat one day with Father, and I'm going to tell you, I lit into him as the most stereotypical Protestant attacking a church arguments that you have ever heard. Now, this pastor was not the most patient of pastors, but by God's good grace that day, he sat there and he listened to me berate him on all the things that were wrong with his church. And at the end of that conversation, he looked at me and he said, Bob, do you like to read? And I said, yeah, I'd like to read. And he said, how about if I give you some material and you read that and you come back and talk to me next week? And I took it. And through God's grace, he slowly began to catechize me. And as I began to understand what the church teaches and why the church teaches on all of its many things, I started to become a little bit in love with our church. I finally came back one day and I said, you know, Father, what would it look like if I wanted to convert to this Catholic faith? And he began to talk to me about RCIA, how it was held at St. John's, how many months it was, how long it took. And with my travel schedule at work, I told him, I don't think I can do it. Maybe there'll be another time, Father. The next week, he called me in and he said, how about this? You come and meet with me, give me your schedule, and we'll go through this together. And over the course of about 8 months, he brought me through the RCIA one-on-one. I was confirmed that year with the graduating confirmation class. There I was, a fully adult man standing up there with all these ninth graders, and the nicest thing was that so many parents said to me that I was the example that their children needed for them to be dragging their kids to confirmation, to classes, to see some adult willingly going. I began to devote more time to the church. I began to lecture. I began to teach CCD. We had a third child, a son, finally, which seemed to indicate that our problems with maintaining our pregnancies were over. I began to devote more and more time, and Irene and I began performing marriage preparation for our parish. We had a fourth child, and then a few years later, I had heard about this diaconate thing. I investigated a little bit, and I found it had some interest to me. So again, I went to my pastor, the same man who had guided me through my RCIA, and asked him if he thought I'd be any good. His concern was the age of our youngest children due to the commitment in time, but in terms of his faith in me, he was fine and very supportive. What I believe was less than a month later, I entered into our 3-month discernment period of what ended up being a 5-year formation process, ultimately in my ordination a little over 3 years ago. In that time, I came to have a greater understanding of the pro-life position through the church's teachings. Every step of the way, I was challenged. In the middle of my formation, I lost my dad. I had to help my mother through these end-of-life decisions as he was in the hospital. Questions about life support, and she turned to me and didn't know what to do. Towards the very end of my formation period, we had to deal with the fact that my mother was going to die from a number of health complications. We took her into our home and we spent any number of sleepless nights with her. During that time, one of my brothers actually asked me if I couldn't just give my mother an overdose of morphine to put her out of her misery. She wouldn't want to live like this. We've heard it, right? I had to explain to him that this was not my or anyone else's decision to make. this was in God's hands, and we were here to take care of her. She lived a little longer. Many, many friends came to our house. Family that had been estranged for years came to our house, broke bread with other family members they hadn't spoken with in years. Ultimately, my pastor came, said a final blessing over her one morning with everyone who was present, and within a couple of hours, she was gone. If there is any power on earth to take someone and push them into a pro-life perspective, it may be dealing with the end-of-life issues of their parents or loved ones. Shortly after, I lost a brother to suicide, took his own life. I went down to Florida, where this had happened, and had to deal with his children and his wife. And if there is any issue that will push someone into a pro-life perspective, it may be dealing with the suicide of a loved one. So there have been many things in my life that have challenged me and brought me to this point. I say that I feel unworthy because if you asked how big our pro-life committee is at our parish, they're all in this room. It's probably my wife and I. The thing is, we should go where we are called to go. We should do everything that we possibly can do. If I waited for my parish to step up behind me, and trust me, there are so many good pro-life people there. But if I waited for them to be the following, we wouldn't be doing anything. A few years ago, I worked with Ken and Mary Nordine, who some of you may know, chaired our president of the Choose Life license plate. Through efforts that each one of us took a diocese. I took the Worcester diocese. A friend took the Boston, another the Fall River, another the Springfield, and we attacked it any and every way we could, with any media, with any videos that I created, with any speaking and showing up at any rallies or any events, any conferences. And as you hopefully know, based on the number of plates I saw on the lot this evening, we're approaching 5,000 plates that are on the road in Massachusetts. At $20 annually, that's for $100,000 that are going to pregnancy resource centers, to baby safe havens, to help with adoptions. I've just recently been asked if I might sit on the board of directors for a pregnancy resource center. And with everything going on in my life with my four children and my other responsibilities, I'm struggling with that, but I'm praying on it. And I'll ask you all to pray for me as well, that I make the right choice, because it's not just that I take that position, it's that I take it if I can do good. You know, I tell you these stories about my pastor, and I tell you these stories about my family, and the important message, and if you'll pardon the expression, I feel like I am preaching to the choir here, is that my pastor met me where I was. He came to me, to my level. And if there is anything that we can do to be successful in this pro-life calling that we have, it's not to stand up there and judge. It's not to stand up there and berate. I know, and I've been, thank you, Lee, at the 40 Days for Life, standing outside. It's to meet these people where they are and to help bring them from where they are to where God wants them to be. Thank you for your time. Amen.